I moved out of the trailer park to a house, mm-hmm. which was a trailer house, but we put a house around it. But I think enough people now, especially after Texas, they're just like, okay.
That's probably not something you'd start up again then.
I hate the term, like, good enough.
Right? Yeah. It's like, for who?
Yeah, not for me.
Yeah. It's good enough for what?
Without further ado, this is Journal of My Journey.
Yours sounded way better than mine.
I grew up in Southeast Kansas mostly. I started out in Girard down in the southeast, very southeast corner, Crawford County. And then I moved up. We bounced around a little bit, but I ended up in Yates Center, Kansas, and that's where I went to school the longest and where I graduated from. And then I did a lot of different things, but I ended up at Hutch JUCO. Went there for a couple of years, and then went to Wichita State. And I'd really never been to Wichita. So that was interesting to move to a big city from a place of 1,500 people and, you know. I don't know if you guys have you guys lived outside of Wichita at all?
Yeah, so I grew up in Hays, Kansas. So
oh.
3 hours from here. But
I grew up in Natoma, Kansas.
I grew up in Natoma. England. So
Spent most of my life overseas.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, when you're from a little bitty town, really probably on the wrong side of the tracks. And then you come to a great big town. It was a kind of a big change for me. I mean, we got the one-bedroom apartment, didn't know anybody, walked across the street, worked at Dairy Queen. It's 1993. Went to WSU. I was very integrated into the college system, even at Hutch JUCO. I did about everything you could think of, from Scholars Bowl to football to student teaching to tutoring. I mean, I was just all around campus all the time. And when I went to WSU, I did the same thing. I was constantly on campus, working, going to school. And in one of my classes, I met a guy that was the student body president, actually. And he had me check out a fraternity. I went over there, checked those guys out. A lot of good dudes. Always, you know, everybody has preconceived notions of different groups of people. And obviously, with my background, I didn't think a lot of fraternity type guys, you know. But when I met them, I immediately realized a lot of these guys were after it. They wanted to get it. And I've always felt that way. And a lot of the guys I hung out with weren't built that way. And I thought, dang, you know, these guys are, you know, a lot of these guys are pretty smart, pretty driven. And I immediately had, you know, the football team. I was in law enforcement before. I mean, just all these groups of guys, I always find myself, I just always, that's just kind of how we roll, you know. So I kind of had a new crew, and through that I was able to get a job at a law firm as a runner, and just, you know, I worked at Wichita Country Club, and I just kind of started to slowly just evaluating Wichita and kind of what it had to offer and all these things. I got through WSU and one thing, and I know you grew up in and around the Air Force or the military, but all my uncles on both sides, my dad, my brother, everybody's been in the military. And I was a Wichita senior honor man, and with that comes another scholarship to stay on campus to do graduate school. And I didn't want to do that, and I took the LSAT because I worked at a law firm. I thought, well, I'll be a lawyer, you know. I grew up kind of around thinking about law enforcement, but I knew to be in the FBI or whatever, you'd have to, you know, it's easier to get a law degree. And I thought all those things over, and I said, you know, I'm just going to go into the military. I'm going to try this deal out. So I took the ASFAB and did well on that, and then they gave me a second test called the defense language aptitude battery, the D-Lab. Mm-hmm. Took that, did really well on that. And they're like, you know, you probably ought to be a linguist, or, you know, and I want to be an MI. So I thought, okay, that's cool. So they shipped me off to the Presidio Monterey defense language school there. And I was in that program doing well, and I was married at the time, and my wife was pregnant, and my feet were just really acting up, just constantly hurting and bleeding, and I was just trying to make do with it. And it was just a thing that they can't really test for. It's called dyshidrosis eczema, and basically pustules pop on your feet, and it's basically like I had jungle foot. Mm-hmm. So I tried all these different boots. I was trying to stay in, and they ended up giving me a medical discharge. So then I came back to Kansas, and, you know, there's no really graduate school now, and I'm out of the military, and I'm not sure what to do, and I have a kid on the way. My wife's pregnant, so I go to work on the ranch farm for her dad, and all the time, through all this, I've been kind of a geek on the side, and was really heavy into, you know, computers and everything that was going on back then, programming and all that kind of deal. So I thought, well, you know, I'm pretty good at this stuff. So I started commuting from out of town into town, and I was testing software, and I did that for a while, all the while keeping my connections at the courthouse and everywhere else that I worked, and ended up getting a job at the City of Kansas 18th Judicial District, and I got hired in as kind of a help desk guy and moved my way up to managing that deal, and then jumped over to Sedgwick County and jumped out of that and went into consulting. Sorry, I'm getting ready.
Yeah,
I love it.
I was trying to speed through that.
No, it's good.
I could go on and on and get into detail, but it's not a, I guess the net of it is it was just kind of a long drive.
Yeah, well, what I got from that too is there's a lot of drive in you. Where do you think you get that from? Would you say that comes
honestly,
from your parents?
No. I'd say the opposite. In fact, I feel like a lot of times they were just okay with the situation. Mm-hmm. I'd say as growing up, want more. I mean, I remember sending I remember sending real snail mail to Davis Moore at the time as the Porsche dealership. Even as a little kid, and I remember liking those cars. I mean, I grew up with that car, and my family's big Harley motorcycle biker family, right? Mm-hmm. Like all the biker parties, like my brother ran a group, like that's a big deal in Southeast Kansas. So I grew up, I mean, we literally had the Harley banner on my house where I lived, yeah.
It's the real deal.
Well, I moved out of the trailer park to a house, mm-hmm. which was a trailer house, but we put a house around it.
Yeah.
So we had this trailer in the middle of a wood frame structure. I can't make this stuff up.
Wow.
And with a, because they're construction folks, right? We had this big, I think it's a 16-foot whistle. You know what that is? Like a big drainage pipe.
Mm-hmm.
We had that inside the house with like a concrete floor in it for a storm shelter, because my mom was scared of storms.
Oh my goodness, that's crazy.
So we so I grew up going to sleep to crazy biker parties the whole time, pretty much. My dad died when I was about 10, and then I lost both my parents actually in 2021.
Or
actually 2020. Yeah,
was it COVID related?
It wasn't, but my mom did have COPD.
Mm.
So, I mean, I don't know if it blew in the door. You know what I mean? You just never really know.
Labeled it COVID.
Yeah. You just, I don't know. But they, as near as I can tell, they didn't label it. But,
yeah,
you know.
You said that you didn't get your drive from them because they were just okay with how it was.
My mom was super, super, super intelligent. And, but just didn't have. She is a hard worker too, don't get me wrong, but she always created her own limitations.
Mm.
She'd always get in her own way, as I like to put it. It's just every time I thought, hey, we're gonna, it just, she would find a reason to blow herself up, you know, in spite of herself. So, but she was okay with that, and that was the part that bothered me. It wasn't like oh, you know, I'll try harder. It's like, eh, it's okay.
Yeah.
I'm like,
it's okay with being content. And
yeah. I'm tired of picking up the phone and telling the bill collectors. I'm tired of, you know, government cheese. I'm tired of that. Why don't you, I mean, even as a little kid, I'm like, why don't you just try a little harder?
Yeah.
You know? But she did what she could.
Yeah.
My mom was very, very much about moving to the U.S. We're in England, and we're going to do it. We're going to move. And I'd be like 8 or 9, she'd be saying it. 10, 11, she'd be saying it. 11, 12. And
isn't that frustrating as a
kid?
When
I graduated high school in England, I was 15. And I fucking moved to the U.S.
Yeah.
And guess who came a year and a half later? My mom. You know, it's like
finally. Then. Good for you.
And my big drive was her, and it was the same thing. It's like, if you want to do it, just do it, you know? Like,
You probably got that out of her inaction.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how I did too. It's like when you see something that frustrates you so much, it just becomes your driving force. Mm-hmm. I think people will see that, even like the recent events. Some people are mad on both sides, but there's like enough's enough.
Yeah.
I mean, whether it be, you know, different protocols or abandoned weapons or somewhere in the middle, everybody's just saying, we're just tired of this shit. You know what I mean? It's not like trying to be one way or the other. I mean, everybody has their own opinions on that, and I for sure do. But either way, I think everybody's just
It's the inaction. It's like the circle. Like, it happens.
Yes.
Ban them or do something. Mass media.
Yeah, something.
Prayers, thoughts.
Right.
Nothing happens. Everything's good for a little bit, and then it happens again.
Right.
Yeah. Like, it circles back around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that just gets frustrating. But I think enough people now, especially after Texas, they're just like, okay.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're all going to be disappointed if something doesn't change. If it's in your favor or not, in your own ideology, I think everybody wants to just see something happen.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean?
And it's been, like, I've seen this, like, over and over lately. Like, there was a lot of growing up, like, people becoming, like, their parents or people becoming, like, how they were raised. And I've seen so much lately of, like, people like, no, like, I'm going to be a change. And I feel like that's just, I don't know, that's refreshing to see in the world to be like,
that's true.
Dang, like, people are stepping up to be like, I'm going to be a change. Like, maybe my dad wasn't around and he was an alcoholic or whatever, abusive or, but I'm not going to be like that. Yeah. And I'm seeing that over and over.
That's good.
People be like, I'm done. This is, it stops right here. And so I'm proud of that.
No, definitely. And it's refreshing that you have a different take, because since we started this podcast and we moved over to, you know, like, Journal of My Journey with Business and Successful People, you are the first person to say that it wasn't because my parents did great and they taught me, drive and all that. It's because you came out of a situation that you didn't want to accept, you know, growing up poor. You're like, no, I want better for myself. I want that Porsche. I want this. So it's great to have like that different perspective.
Well, I think it's harder. There'd be more of us, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you can say, a lot of people are saying that.
Right.
It's pretty hard to put in action, because it's real easy to just follow what you already know is acceptable or follow whatever you've seen happen and just consider that normal.
Yeah.
And it's just not.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you need to create your own reality. I mean, it might mimic what you've seen in the past. It might not.
Yeah.
You know, but you have to be the author.
Yeah, and that's something I've walked through a little bit. My dad was definitely, like, not a present father. The only thing I learned from him was work ethic, because he was a workaholic. So he was always gone, always working. Being around him was not great. But like,
well, then what you learned is probably not work ethic, but work-life balance.
Yeah.
Because I can tell that bothered you.
Yeah. I was like, no, this is not who I'm going to be as a dad. This is not who I'm going to be present. I'm going to work my ass off too.
Sure.
So I'm like, that's a balance. And sometimes I do lean on the side of, like, I could easily just work. I could easily tell the kids, like, hey, I've got work to do. And I've been trying to work on that, you know, throughout my entire life. But on the other side, I've got, like, a brother that is just off the deep end, like, crazy, went the other way and is a lot like him and leaned into that and then just became who my father was. And so it's just like, it's interesting to kind of to see how people can choose their destiny. Like, they can say whatever, and that's something I've seen a lot, like, saying I'm gonna be different, I'm gonna be like, are you actually doing it though? Right. Like, are you actually making difference? Like,
It's tough.
It is.
How do you think the Army thing affected you? I mean, it was something you really wanted to do, and then, I mean...
It was, and I was good at it. I was a good soldier. I just... it was a letdown. I'm one of these guys, when I get started, I probably would have tried to advance and sign up for as many things as possible, and, you know, who knows where I would have went, you know? Probably would have retired. It was a bitter pill. I was like, I mean, it's one of those things, it's like, there's not too many occupations where a disability will get you fired.
Yeah.
Especially nowadays.
Yeah.
Still happens in the military. I mean, you have to be ready to go. And I was great in the 99 other areas. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, this weird skin condition on the bottoms of my feet. I mean, I was good at everything else. And I was, that was one of those things where you just get mad at the world.
Yeah.
No one can control it.
Right.
You know, but I don't know. It really caught me off guard, and I had a trial on the way. Like I said, I was coming back to a state I'd, you know, already had left, and I just, there was not a failure feeling. I was excited to see my family, obviously, but I just my body let me down, and that's a weird feeling. You know, that happened a couple years ago. I had a shoulder replacement, and you know, you kind of remember just how mortal you are sometimes when you get an ailment or a sickness or something, and that drives that whole gratitude thing. And I'm big on that. I'm big on being thankful, and you know, I don't really believe in luck as much as the, you know, putting yourself in the right position and, you know, opportunity and all that, but. You know, it does seem like if you work harder, you know, the luckier you are.
Right.
I love that. You know, I just, it was kind of humbling, I guess, to answer your question.
Yeah.
There's not a lot you can do. It's one of those things like, all right, pick yourself up, you know, get knocked down two times, get up three. You know, it's one of those things. Going. Yeah. I mean, I had to figure it out.
Was it, You said, you know, I get after it. When that happened, when you came back, was there a time where you just kind of, you sat around, you moped a little bit, or are you just right back at it?
No, in fact, the day I got back, this is kind of a crazy story. I jumped right on a tractor, and we were out in the pasture, and there's a document called a DD-214, and it's kind of like your discharge papers. And I also have my ID and my driver's license, and it seems like a check, and just everything that's important in my world in my wallet, which was in my jeans. So first day I get up, 6 a.m. or whatever, her dad's name was Rick, great guy, but anyways, we go out, and I'm moving these bales all over the pasture, and I'm driving this tractor, and I get home that night, I'm dog tired, and you know, I didn't take any days off, to your point. And I started patting around and started asking my wife, you know, Kelly, is like, have you seen my wallet? And sure enough, that wallet was gone. And I was like, it's kind of like everything else in my life. I put myself in a position I have to accomplish, you know. It's like, well, I know exactly where I was. I know what pasture I was in. And her dad's like, dude, there's no way you're going to find. I mean, we covered a lot of acres and a lot of time. It's like, no, I mean, I just have to. And I went out there and I started looking, and I you know, it's probably like a big fish story. I can't remember correctly, but I felt like I walked almost directly to it, but I did find it out there. And that's why I know I didn't take any days off. Cause I remember I was so relieved, cause like the whole rest of my life depended on those documents in the near future, you know? And it's like, geez, you know, I got pretty lucky, but it seems like I get reunited with things I lose and luckily somehow, but you got to look for them to find them.
Yeah.
And you know, everybody in that house was like, you're not gonna find that. And I was like, bullshit, I'm getting in the truck, I'm going looking.
Yeah.
And I found it. Yeah.
You got to just a level of determination that's unreal.
That's the thing. Yeah, I just don't want to
quit. That just something that's just always been ingrained in you, or do you think
I guess I just whenever I'm showing up somewhere, it's like a lot of times it's, you know, I'm a troubleshooter, right? By trade. I mean, that's what I do. And I just always want to figure it out. And usually, I mean, if you look at my past, everything I've done, you know, we talked about, you know, Canaan a little bit, the wine bar, but is bringing groups of people together, shift around a common mm-hmm. interest, mm-hmm. you know, SI, try to make it an experience, you know, you know, and I just love groups of people, especially men, that get together. And it's like, all right, let's go, you know, figure this out. You know, I was with a small group of guys. We started Wichita Whiskey Club like 12 or 13 years ago now. And there's only two of us now that are original members that are still in. That's probably 25 people. And the whole reason I helped start that is I just want to learn more about whiskey. That was it. I was like, and you're like, well, I kind of like whiskey. I'd like to learn about it. And he says, and I was like, well, let's just do this, you know?
Yeah.
I had a buddy that started a race team. He's like, hey, man, you know, I've been looking into this. And, dude, we dived into that thing. Next thing we knew, we took a passenger car. We're, you know, cutting the interior out of it and, you know, building a roll cage and just crazy stuff that we've never – and anybody that gets a chance to just dive into something like that and bring a couple of their buddies or friends along, you've got to do it, no matter what it is.
Yeah.
You know, but it's just a common interest I have found that just – if you can draw people together, you're starting with something that everybody loves.
Right.
And from then it can just explode.
Yeah.
And, you know, probably my favorite business right now that I have is Shift, because that's what happens every time people are in there. There's all kinds of different backgrounds now. You know, we've been going 2 or 3 years, over 100 members. And they're bringing different, you know, there might be a marketing guy with a real estate developer and a banker all sitting together. Well, guess what happens? Companies, that's what happens, or deals, or, and I love seeing that happen. I mean, when I see that, or, you know, I have a barbecue, I cook for everybody once a month, and they show up, and it's just different walks of life too. People bring people that are from out of town, or they're visiting, and just to see that interaction, and it's just, to me, that is probably my most favorite thing or most powerful thing that I can do, is just try to bring groups of people together and just have a good time, man. Yeah. Just live life and try to gather around common interest.
Yeah.
That's it.
I mean, life gets so busy. So it's just like that to me is like such a peaceful spot, like getting people out of like their daily grind and just like get around people that have like a common interest and just like, like community is so huge.
That's
and
what it really is. That's the word, community.
Yeah. But 100%. I feel like that's fading. As like, especially as like COVID hit, a lot of like community like kind of faded away. So now we have to, we actually have to like work a little harder to kind of keep that back, to, you know, keep that going. And I think like the world is coming back to like community is important. They've been separated for too long.
Yeah.
And maybe like re-adding value to what community is. Cause a lot of people just like, I'm naturally an introvert, so like I'm okay with being alone, but I do love being around people.
Sure.
And especially like what we're building on this company is like the common interest of video and photo, and everybody that's on our team loves what we do. So I definitely see the value in like bringing a group of people together and men together, like, hey, like there's value in this. I love doing this. You love doing this. I mean, I grew up, I'm not a mechanic at all, but I grew up, I've got a 63 Ford sitting outside that I had two 62 Chevys and two 64s that I was basically making into one truck in all through high school. And I grew up with that world. And so I finally just got this 63 out here, three on the tree, had to relearn how to drive a three on the tree. But I have an appreciation and a love for that, even if I don't have like a actual like lots of knowledge.
Sure.
Like I can work on it, but I don't know what the hell I'm doing.
No, but that's the fun part. Right?
Yeah. I love that. Oh, we've only been in I've been in Shift once. That one time we shot you on your bike.
Yeah.
And just the wow factor of, and that was like almost, that was like 2 years ago or something.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So being in there, just like seeing all these cars and motorcycles and like, dude, it was such a wow. I'm like trying to film you, but I'm like
looking around. Yeah.
Well, so what you can check it out.
For those that don't know, like explain Shift.
Sure. So Shift is what I basically call a country club for car guys, but it really isn't a country club feel in the elitist since obviously you guys know my background, it really what it is a luxury storage facility. So guys can come and go. The facility's open 24/7. It's mostly unmanned. I mean, unless I'm in the building.
Yeah.
Which I'm not a lot. I mean, guys can come and go as they please, but you know, we've got that whole social side of storage. So to me, that's the most important part, because that is where you create community and culture and fun. And so there's a clubhouse there, there's a patio, you know, we've got everything from, you know, shuffleboard and pool tables to meeting rooms. I mean, and guys use it in all kinds of different ways. I have more social and corporate members than I do storage members, and I'm almost out of storage spots, but thank goodness. But people are seeing the value of it as a place to network and hang out and, you know, have events. I mean, it's been used as a venue for all kinds of great local events, and it's really kind of grown to the point where a lot of other metro, I probably have four other metro areas where investors have called me and said, hey, we see what you're doing, we've seen how you've done it, would you be willing to kind of franchise this thing? And that might be the next step, I don't know. But what I found was pretty special, because of an old dealership, obviously Wichita means a lot to me, downtown Wichita especially means a lot to me, and I drove past that dealership for 10 years working at the county and the state, and always looking over into the showroom or whatever. And, you know, it was a party rental company for a long time. And then, you know, other things started popping up in there. And I always thought, man, if I could ever get a chance to buy that building, and I had that opportunity. And I was already storing cars for guys. I had a building down in, I'll just call it the hood. And, you know, we're dragging fences open and closed, dirt roads. And these guys were parking Lamborghinis and Vipers and stuff down here. And, I mean, serious cars in this little building. But they knew I'd take care of them. You know, they're Air Force pilots and things like this. And, they knew they'd be gone. And then we're pretty much running our endurance race team out of there with a couple other buddies. And so we were down there drinking and high-fiving and wrenching and, you know, kind of doing the shift thing already. And I thought, you know, this could really be something bigger and more fun, and I could do it better, actually, in a better location and a bigger location, obviously. And so when I saw that building, I just knew what I wanted to do is kind of bring my passion forward and have fun with it. And that's where I think if you chase that, I believe that the money or the fun or whatever you're looking for will come. Mm-hmm. It really will. It's just because it's natural to you, right? You're not going to work. You're not trying, you know. Yeah. But it's a lot of fun.
It's pretty cool to see, like, you're driving by, like, yeah, I want that. That's the building. And then it just, like, comes into fruition. Like, you're like, oh, yeah, that is the building.
Yeah.
You're there now. Like, when I drive by, I'm like, oh, yeah, look at those cars in the window. Like, you know, it's cool. We do that all the time. Like, think of the future of, like, okay, this is where we're going. This is the future. This is the vision.
Yeah. Where do we want to build a studio?
Yeah.
Right.
Other than my basement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there's a lot of that. And I respect the side of, like, even just having that vision, like, that's going to be something, like, even just like feeling it, like, man, that's something valuable. Like, that's a place that I could see myself.
Well,
at.
4 years ago, that was a really out of the box idea, because most people, and even myself, I bought into this condo warehouse thing out east. And everybody had their own shoebox. They made their own little man cave. They all put in, bathrooms and mezzanines and bars. Yeah. And they were all doing the same thing. And then there was a clubhouse that was still on the same piece of ground that no one ever walked into.
Yeah.
I said, this is upside down, you know.
This makes sense.
I want a building where it's open. Well, when you do that and you got these kind of guys with these kind of cars, they're like, And that's the exact secret of it, though, is because you build that level of trust.
Yeah.
That guy knows that he's trusting me. Anybody that comes in that door is going to respect his property you know, we're going to have events the right way. We're going to have fun. Everything's going to be taken care of properly. And that's a big turn. So when people start saying, man, this guy can do this in one wide open building, that's pretty nuts, you know, because the expenses,
yeah,
making all those shoe boxes. But the downside of it is no one gets to know each other. I used to call the guy that was right next door to me. Hey, dude, are you over there? Yeah, I'm here. I'm not. And it's like, do we all need lights to click on outside? I mean, to me, but, you know, as just Americans, everybody wants their own little box of stuff and they want to protect it as tight as possible. Mm-hmm. So I think bringing that open, you know, bring probably your second largest investment in your life, put in this building and trust it to me. And oh, by the way, there's no walls around it.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool, man.
Yeah. That's a big deal.
I feel very obligated to these folks to take care of their property and then balance letting a lot of my social and corporate members have the fun that they want to also.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
I love that.
Yeah.
So we talked about that being, you know, pretty successful, and there's obviously in businesses and starting them, there's the other side where sometimes it doesn't work out. It's Cana, is that right?
Cana,
yeah. Cana.
Mm-hmm.
So you started this amazing bar and
COVID
hit and things kind of went like a little bit south. What happened there?
Yeah, I mean, without getting into terrible lot of detail, so where Cana is from kind of everything else, I kind of took a gamble early on in the path of progress, and I'm happy to see it's all happening. Everything I said that would happen is happening. But it was on basically two blocks south of Douglas on Broadway, which used to be trapped between basically the old bus station and Broadway. The bus station's been purchased, beautiful remodel by SPT Architecture. I mean, the building's outstanding now. Suda's done exactly what she said she was going to do. There's two schools coming in. And all those things were known early on. Well, of course, COVID slowed all those things down. And everybody quit driving downtown to go to work. So we pretty much overnight, besides the government closing our business, I mean, it was bad enough to be told you have to shut down, but even worse when you open back up, no one's down there to see you. Right. And in an already area that's a little bit dodgy to get traffic because there just wasn't that population density around there yet, or reason to be around there yet, which I really am looking forward to those schools being open down there. I think it's going to be huge and it's going to be a lot of fun. But either way, we just did not. I didn't get any PPP money or any of those types of things because I didn't have employees per se. And long story short, we just kind of weathered the storm. I kept everybody employed that I could, really until the very end. And just it was kind of a combination of poor management, and I'll even say it was on me as much as anybody, and COVID, you know. The bar and restaurant business is something that, you know, I grew up working, you know, from 13 on, washing dishes at a little roadside inn. It's a tough business if you're not in it every day and seeing what's going on and who's doing what. It's not an absentee owner business. And obviously, as you guys know, I have a couple businesses, a day job and a real estate company to run, and that was the last plate that I would spin. I mean, I had a GM. I believed in what they were saying was happening, and I wasn't there to verify, you know, trust but verify. I was not verifying, and I found out, you know, that things were happening that I didn't know about, and we weren't getting the business any, you know, like we were before. And, you know, it's another bitter pill, but it's one of those things where it was almost like a relief. I got started in that business, honestly trying to help someone else live their dream. And early on that didn't work out. And I was kind of stuck with it. So I worked as hard as I could to keep good jams in there and keep the quality of the service and the product up, which was happening. I mean, we won awards. It was a great bar from that respect. I don't think anyone can deny that. It's just keeping it going.
Yeah.
There wasn't a true champion of that business, myself included. I mean, I didn't wake up one day saying, hey, we ought to – I knew what Wichita needed, yeah. And I agreed, but I didn't say, hey, I want to run a bar.
Right.
You know, it wasn't like that. So,
that's probably not something you'd start up again then?
No, and I've been asked. I've even said, well, you know, would you do Canaan somewhere else? Or would you, you know, I think we did have a great following. We had great customers. We had great cocktails. I mean, I do think there was a lot coming out of Canaan that Wichita needs and accepted and does believe in. It's just one of those things. Wichita's kind of fickle. It's like I've had a lot of people say, man, I want to have an event there. Or, mm-hmm. Are you guys home? And I'm like, where were you?
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those things like, where were you?
Yeah.
You know, but on the other side of it, I get it. I mean, I understand. And it was just one of those deals where it just didn't work out.
So you have a day job.
Yeah.
And you do all of these businesses too.
Yeah.
You sound, man. I guess I kind of do similar thing, but not as many. It's one business. But.
Yeah. I think everybody is kind of, I think that side hustle mentality, I just think I was early on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now everybody, especially after COVID, you know, they've developed their hobby or their passion to a sideline deal, or they've met someone that they can sell for or help with or whatever. And I feel like now there's a lot more of that and it's a lot more accepted. Yeah. And I'm actually kind of happy to see that, but I do want to see people with passion do one thing really, really well. Mm-hmm. And I'm scared that we're all rushing into mediocrity from that perspective. I mean, where they're going to be like, well, you know, I do this pretty good and that pretty good, and we're going to all turn into a bunch of pretty good people. You know, I don't, you know what I mean?
I can see that across the board. Yeah. I see that all the time. Like, people are like, oh, that's okay. That's good enough.
Yeah.
I hate the term, like, good enough. Like, I tear that apart. I'm like, it's not
for good. Who? Yeah, that's a very subjective term, like, right? Yeah. It's like, for who?
Yeah, not for me.
Yeah, it's good enough for what? You're speaking for yourself. Yeah. You know what I mean? But you're not the one buying it. Yeah. You're the one creating it.
Exactly. Yeah, but that's like such a, I hear that term so much. And it just instantly, I'm just like, all right, now we're going to tear it apart. Because like, once you get to that side of like, it is good enough, it's like, you've already given up on like excellence. You've given up on the next level. Like we talk all the time, like there's always so much room for growth. Like this might be the best thing we've put out so far, but we could step it up here on the colors. We could step it up on the storytelling. We could step up whatever it might be.
Right.
There's always that next level. So good enough is like, it just bothers me so much.